place is full of your presence. I am overwhelmed with joy. Unspeakable joy. The Bible says full of glory. This place is full of his glory. My heart is full of his glory.
Thank you, Lord.
Every fiber of my being is full of his glory.
Yes.
That's what happens when you tap in to his presence.
Yes.
That's what happens when you tap in and accept the invitation. When the Holy Spirit invites us to come into the inner courts and we just take every weight off of us and we dive in and we get what he has for us. This is the end result. But it's not an end result, it's an ongoing result, because more than ever before, our Heavenly Father wants us to stay in that place. And it's imperative that we stay in that place, for he knows what's yet to come into the in the future for each and every one of our lives. He knows what we're dealing with. He knows what we're battling. He knows what we're facing. He knows what we'll face in the future. He knows what we have faced in the past. And he is saying that we are moving forward as long as we stay in that place. How many of you want to stay in that place? How many of you just want to stay and abide in that place where the Holy Spirit resides? The Holy Spirit is our lifeline, amen? The Holy Spirit is our pick-me-up. The Holy Spirit is where we can go and get recharged and refilled, because more than ever before, you know, we thought in the past we couldn't do it without him. More than ever before, we need him each and every day. I'm constantly reminded of that old hymnal this whole week where my grandmother used to sing, I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour, I need thee. Oh, bless. You remember that hymnal?
Yes.
And that's a cry from my heart. I need thee, Lord.
Yes,
Lord. That is a cry that the Holy Spirit wants from his children. And we need to tell him each and every day how much we need him. Because when we get detached from him, when a storm comes in, we begin to get tossed to and fro. We're hit from every angle because we're not anchored in the foundation that God has for us. When we tap into his presence, boy, there's a refreshing, there's a refilling, there's a rejuvenating. How many of y'all feel refreshed this morning? How many of you feel rejuvenated this morning? How many of you feel charged up this morning? I don't know about you, I feel light as a feather. Even though I'm in the process of losing weight, you know, there's a lightness about me that, you know, my whole disposition has changed. Because when you allow the Holy Spirit to step in, I've got the hugest smile on my face. I'm so geeked out right now because of what the Holy Spirit is doing in your life, in my life, in everybody else's lives that's connected to us.
Yes.
If you believe that, give God a hand clap of praise.
Yes.
Hallelujah. I will not be before you long, but boy, the Holy Spirit is awesome.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit is awesome.
Amen.
Man, the Holy Spirit has been downloading these past couple of days, actually, these past 2 weeks, amen. And I choose to believe that the Holy Spirit has been downloading unto you. The Holy Spirit has been giving each and every one of us strategy. The Holy Spirit has been guiding us and leading us unto all truth. Is that you? Am I the only one in here?
No.
Oh, that's what I thought. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So in my seeking this week, the Holy Spirit led me to shift a little and expound on a very simple concept. Amen. Are y'all with me?
Amen.
But I want to use a very popular idiom to deliver it to you. The concept that the Holy Spirit wants to indulge us on for the next couple of moments, and the idiom that he wanted me to use is weathering your storms. Weathering your storms. Father God, I thank you for this word. I thank you that this word is that is about to be planted in our hearts. I thank you that every heart in here and every heart connected to us, it's fertile. It's fertile ground, and I thank you for the seeds that are about to come from your word. It's going to be planted deep on the inside of us, and those seeds are going to take root, and it's going to allow us to grow, because more than ever before, we need to take root in you for the storms that have yet to come, God. And we thank you, Father God. We thank you that you're a loving God, that you give us strategy for the up and coming battles. We thank you that you're a loving God, that you give us power to endure a thing. We thank you that you're a loving God, that you are seeking, and you are searching the inner beings of us, because you, more than ever before, you want us to be more and more like you. Thank you that you're a God, that you're concerned about us, you're concerned about our well-being, and we thank you that the word that you are going to deliver today will do just that. It'll bring alignment, it'll bring fortification, it'll cause us to be planted even more in you, so that we can grow more in you, in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want you to tell your neighbor, say neighbor,
neighbor.
Loud and clear. Neighbor,
neighbor.
Are you able
to weather
your storms? Loud and clear. Say neighbor,
neighbor.
Are you able
to weather your storms.
Amen. The idiom weathering the storm simply means this: to experience and survive a storm. Are y'all with me?
Amen.
To continue to exist and not be harmed during a difficult period. Are y'all with me? When you weather a storm, it means that to be all right despite experiencing serious problems or great difficulties. When you're weathering a storm, that means you're a ship and you're able to come safely through bad weather. I believe in my heart that this topic is very relevant due to what's going on and what is still going on in our nation today. Houston just experienced a horrific storm, and the city had to create a problem in order to avoid a bigger problem from happening. But still, the aftermath that took place, whether it be on purpose or naturally, are y'all with me? Thousands of people were and still are affected in a big way. All eyes are glued to the TV because Hurricane Irma has hit the newsstands, and people are wondering what is about to happen. The mayor and the governor of Florida has issued a state of emergency, and residents all over South Florida are being urged to not wait it out. They're being asked to evacuate. But Jesus Christ spoke very candidly on the very fact that storms will come. I want you to tell your neighbor, storms will come. We aren't excluded from it because we are children of the Most High God. We don't have some special weather pass that we're rewarded for our good deeds, like the free homework pass that I was given when I was in high school. I'll never forget, I won a free homework pass, and I was like, yes, calculus. I can avoid that homework. And then, you know, I took that homework pass and I slammed it on Mr. Vincent's desk. Go figure. My calculus teacher was named Mr. Vincent. I was so glad for that homework pass because it gave me something that I didn't have to endure, more so I didn't want to endure. I was like, bam! Like I was playing spades. I was about to win a hand. I was like, here you go. I don't need this homework assignment. But tell your neighbor, no.
No.
Loud and clear, no.
No.
Storms don't work like that. Jesus said very clearly, storms will come. And I want you to turn to your neighbor. There's one question that God wants to ask us today. And he's asking us, tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, is the foundation of your life up to the task of weathering the storm?
Good question.
It's a very good question. I heard it very loud and clear in a dream 2 days ago. And one thing the Holy Spirit gave me was the concept of a house. I want you to stop and think about the house that you live in. Are y'all with me? If I were to ask you to describe your house, everybody in here would be able to tell me how many rooms there are, the color of the paint on the walls, even the color of the brick, even down to the wallpaper in your bathroom. You can describe how your house looks. And some of you would be so proud, you would even start explaining all the renovations that are taking place in your house. But I don't think a lot of people would be able to talk about the foundation of your house. I'm pretty sure one person in here can. That's Daddy Hayes, because I'm always mesmerized by his testimony about the house. But I bet you Daddy Hayes could talk about the very foundation that goes into his house. But the average person probably couldn't go into a lot of detail about the foundation of the house. Are y'all with me? Perhaps you don't know anything about the foundation, but yet it is the foundation of your house that makes all the difference. Are y'all with me? If you need proof, turn with me to Proverbs 24, and I'm going to read verses 3 through 6. Proverbs 24, verses 3 through 6. And it says here, by wisdom a house is built, and through understanding it is established. Verse 4, through knowledge its rooms are filled with rare and beautiful treasures. Verse 5, the wise prevail through great power, and those who have knowledge muster their strength. Verse 6, surely you need guidance to wage war, and victory is won through many advisors. Turn to your neighbor and say, this is not only true,
for your house,
but this is true,
for your life.
We'll say it again. This is true, for your life. Here is what Jesus had to say about your life being built on the right foundation when storms come. Are y'all with me? Here's what Jesus had to say. And I want to turn to your attention to a very popular parable that Jesus used with two builders. And he compares and contrasts two builders, one wise and one foolish. And he emphasizes how critical it is to have a strong foundation. Are y'all with me? To use the building metaphor is not a surprise, because we know that Jesus is a carpenter. If he was here today, he would probably be working for Havities, making some of the greatest furniture of all time. And I'm sure back in his day, Jesus probably built some houses too. Are you with me? And then when it comes to Jesus and his natural expertise, when it comes to building things and building homes, Jesus knew the difference between a solid house and a shabby one. However, this story is not just for architects and for contractors and carpenters, but this story is also for you and I. Tell your neighbor, this story is for you.
This story is for you. Yeah.
Building a house is simply an analogy of building your life. And the point is this, you are building a life, and the foundation you choose is the most important feature of your life. And this is what Jesus said about building for your life. Turn with me to Matthew 7, verses 24 through 27. This is a very familiar parable. I believe for all you biblical theologians, this was the Sermon on the Mount, if I'm not mistaken. But he talks about two builders, a wise one and a foolish one. And the Holy Spirit has had me use this parable to set the stage of how important it is when we get into a season in our life when we have to weather some storms. Are y'all with me? And it says here in Matthew 7:24, it says here, therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice like a wise man who built his house on a rock. Then 25, it says, the rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew and beat against that house, yet it did not fall because it has a foundation on a rock. The first point that I want to bring to you, for all of you who like to write notes, I want you to, the Holy Spirit wants us to listen and practice. Everybody say listen.
Listen
and practice.
And practice.
By using the word everyone, Jesus is revealing, and he reveals that his words are intended for all people for all time. He begins by stating that you must hear his words. In order to do that, you must expose yourself to the truth of his word. And while this may sound daunting, or there's all different forms of how we can expose ourselves to the truth, whether it be going to church every Sunday, worshiping, more importantly, reading the word of God, spending time with the Holy Spirit, that it is necessary more than ever before. We live in a day and an age that we must seek and search out the truth, because there is some necessary information in this book we call the true and living word of God that we need to stay planted in our lives each and every day, so that when storms come, we can remain planted on the solid rock, which is Jesus Christ, so that we won't be swayed to and fro.
Amen.
Y'all with me?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Athletes listen to coaches and more experienced players. A craftsman becomes an apprentice, because a craftsman wants to get to where that expert is. Are y'all with me? A student teacher learns from a teacher in a classroom environment. In all of these different cases, it's essential to not just hear the truth, but to listen to the truth. If anybody in here is married, you know that there's a difference. Courtney gets me every day. She knows I might be hearing her, but there may be times that I'm not listening to her. There's a big difference. And when I'm like, huh? She's like, see, you weren't even listening to me. She didn't even use the word hear. She used listen. There is a difference. You can hear the word, but are you listening to the word? Are y'all with me? Anyone who used to have a teenager, you know the difference. Your teenager might be listening to, hearing you, but they're not listening to you. I don't have a teenager yet. Micah's only 5, and I'm already dealing with that. I'm like, Micah, huh? It's 2 minutes later. He might hear me, but is he actively listening to what I'm trying to tell him?
Right.
Already at 5. Amen. Hallelujah. The best listeners are ones who actively, they listen and they ask clarifying questions. And we're living a day and age that more than ever before, when it comes to interacting with the Holy Spirit and spending time with the Holy Spirit, we got to be like, Holy Spirit, what are you saying? What do you mean when you said this? Well, what are you trying to tell you? Are you trying to warn me? Are you telling me I need to repent? Is there something I need to do, or is there something you want me to declare in prayer? That's what it means to actively listen to the Holy Spirit. And Jesus urges you to hear his words, but he doesn't stop just there. He says you must act on his words. Everybody say act.
Act.
If you are going to build on a solid foundation, you must actually do what Jesus is telling you to do. Hearing his words is not enough. You are building your life on his words only as you obey them as well. When the Holy Spirit revealed this to me, it brought conviction. I was like, Holy Spirit, forgive me. Because when you read James 1:22, it says here, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Because if you only hear the word, you run into a place where you'll deceive yourselves. We've been engineered that when we listen to something, we must actively do it. Why do you think there's two modalities of learning? Not everybody can just listen to something and actually learn for it. The majority of people on this earth, they actually have to work it out, do it, and it becomes implanted in their brain, because when it comes implanted in their brain, it will be hard for them to leave it. You know, that very skill is rooted and grounded in you. And that's what it means when it comes to the Word of God. Not only are we listening to the Word of God, but we're actively working out the Word of God in our lives so that the Word of God can be planted on the inside of us, so that when storms come, we can stand firm.
Amen.
We can stand firm. There's a lot of things you hear. Raise your hand if you believe that when you brush and floss your teeth, your teeth will be healthy. You heard it all your life. I heard that same thing, and I'm gonna be naked and not ashamed right now. You know, there was a period in my life where I didn't floss my teeth. As straight and as white as my teeth are, I didn't floss. And when I finally go to the dentist, I'm so shocked because I have 10 cavities that I got to deal with. And then I got to find $600 to try to fill those cavities. All because I knew something was true, but I didn't act on it. We know what the Word says, but we don't act on it. When a storm comes, we come tossed right to the left, and we don't have anything to stand on because we didn't work it out. Are y'all with me?
Amen.
A very simple concept. It was reported in 1992. Hurricane Andrew, this is a hurricane I missed, thank God. Hurricane Andrew swept through Florida and wiped out everything. It looked like a war zone. All the houses were wiped out except for one. And the reporter went to the man that built that house. And you know what that man told him? He said, I built this house myself. Not only did he do that, he listened or he read there was an article that Florida sent out. If you want your house to withstand a hurricane, make sure you build this house in these certain dimensions. So not only did he hear and read and actively listen to what that article was saying, he actually acted out what that article was suggesting that he do when it came to building his dream home. And when Hurricane Andrew, which is one of the worst hurricanes that ever swept through Florida, came through, his house was the only house that stood. And he told the reporter, I followed the guidelines that Florida issued out and that I needed to build my home. It was these dimensions, and I did it, and that is why my house still stood. All houses were leveled, but his house, he checked the foundation, and it was sturdy like a rock because he actively listened and actively walked out and worked out and carried out what was suggested to him. And when a storm came, his house was still standing.
Come on, man.
But how many times in our lives, when a storm we go through, which Jesus said we will go through storms, how many times have we been in a storm in our life and we're tossed to and fro? Too many. Too many for me. Too many. Too many times I knew what the Word says, but then I didn't actively act out the Word. And then guess what? When a storm came, I was right back where I was because I didn't actively work it out. Are y'all with me? Tell your neighbor, don't just listen. But put it to practice. Loud and clear. Don't just listen. But put it to practice. Now yell at your neighbor, I got to.
I have no choice.
We have no choice.
Amen.
We have no choice. Now there are some benefits to putting God's work or word into practice. Are y'all with me? Are y'all with me? Turn with me to, let's go back to Matthew 7. This is what verse 25 said. Now, verses 23 and 24 talk about what happens when you're a wise man. And not only do you hear Jesus' words, but you do them. You're like a wise man who builds his house on solid rock. Are y'all with me?
Mm-hmm.
And verse 25 said, the rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew and beat against the house, and yet it did not fall because it had a foundation on a rock. Which leads to my next point. Because you're going to face some storms. My next point is this, point number two. Storms are conditional. Storms are conditional. Well, Vincent, what do you mean? Well, I'll tell you. Notice when we read that particular passage, right? Jesus said that the rain came, the streams rose, the winds blew. Jesus did not hold back any punches when he said this. He didn't say that if the rains come, he said the rain came, which lets us know storms will come. It's inevitable. We are going to face storms, not because we're sinning or whatever the case may be, but you know, there's some things you really got to look at as to why we are going to face storms anyway. And guess what? Storms will come because there are things in place that act as the perfect petri dish of ingredients for the storm to brew and come together and manifest. Are y'all with me? When you look at it from a natural sense, before a hurricane becomes what we know it is, it starts as a tropical storm. If you were able to peer back the atmospheric layers, you'll be able to see what's taking place behind the scenes. There's a right amount of warm air currents clashing with the right amount of cold air currents. And when those two currents come together, that's what you call the storm front, because there's an imbalance. Are y'all with me? When you parallel that to what's going on in our lives, there are times in our lives where certain things are in play in our lives that have the potential, under the right circumstances, with the right mixture, to cause a storm to manifest. We also know that Satan, the enemy of our souls, is the prince of the airwaves. Because of sin, he was given jurisdiction to cause storms to enter in our lives to a certain degree. But aren't you glad that you serve a God that has the ability to see behind the scenes? Aren't you glad that you serve a God that gives you the ability to see behind the scenes? Aren't you glad that you can see the storms that are brewing from afar? You serve a God that can see the storms that are brewing from afar. You serve a God who knows the exact coordinates and trajectories and coordinates with which the storms are rolling in, the path that is taken, just like the Doppler radar does. We serve a God who knows. So when he knows, he is actively telling us through his word, stay equipped. Because I see a storm 5 days from now, and I need you to read and stay in my place, in my presence. Why do you think God gave us such an awesome experience today? What we know is because he loves us, but we don't know what's ahead, but he does. And when we finally face it, we can tap into what happened today, what's rooted on the inside of us today, and we have what we need to stand. We have what we need to stand. That's why we have the Holy Spirit who's been sent to us to lead us and guide us into all truth. Because if our foundation is the truth, which is the living word of God introduced by his son Jesus, then when those storms come, our house, aka our lives, will not fall. Amen. Give God a hand clap of praise when we stay connected to God. When the storms that will eventually come, they will not fall. Why? Because it's been built on a solid foundation. Jesus the rock. Everybody say, Jesus the rock. Jesus. Loud and clear. Jesus,
Jesus
the rock,
the rock
will forever be,
will forever be
my foundation.
My foundation.
And we can take pride. We can take a 30-second praise break and say, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Y'all blessed.
Amen.
Point number three. This is gonna make Dad get up and dance right here. Dad, get prepared to do the nay-nay. I know I did. Point number three, it didn't even look right, but I was praising him. Point number three, watch what you are feeding the storm when you are in one. Watch what you are feeding the storm when you are in one. Watch what you are feeding the storm when you are in one. You hear me?
Amen.
So I chose this picture because this is a Doppler radar image of Hurricane Irma. Y'all with me?
Mm-hmm.
I've been keeping up with this hurricane because this could potentially have direct effect on my family. For those of you that know, my family's in Florida. All my family's in Florida. And Hurricane Irma has the potential to directly affect them in a huge way. So last night, I was looking on the news, and the newscasters repeatedly referred to Irma as the storm of the century. And the reason why they gave Irma that title was because it is a feeding storm. Are y'all with me here?
Uh-huh.
It is a feeding storm. One key aspect that the meteorologists did not want to happen was for Irma to go into the Gulf of Mexico because of the large amounts of warm water that's in the Gulf. And if you are a hurricane, one thing you want, your food source, your supply of your strength, is a large amount of warm water.
Uh-huh.
So things have to be in place in the atmosphere for a hurricane to grow. But since a hurricane is pretty much a water storm that comes onto land, the hurricane feeds on warm water. So Irma has been depicted as a feeding storm. And one thing the meteorologist said, if it gets to the Gulf, it has the potential to increase back up to a Category 5. And if I'm not mistaken, it did that. The hurricane is in the Gulf of Mexico, and the strength is currently rising up again. That's why when it hits Tampa, it's going to be a Category 5, and as it goes inland, it'll get smaller and smaller and smaller. But it still has a potential to go way in the Gulf, all the way up to the Panhandle, because of what's feeding that hurricane. The meteorologist said, Irma is a feeding hurricane. And when it passed the Caribbean islands, it was down to a 3. And then once it got to that little shelf where Miami, and I don't know my geography too well, where Miami is, once it passed that, it went back up again. A feeding hurricane. Sometimes, and the Holy Spirit said so clearly, Vincent, when you're in a storm, you gotta watch what you feed the storm while you're in it. Are y'all with me?
Mm-hmm.
I promise you this is about to get good. As it feeds, the storm gets stronger, and then Irma is increasing in strength because it's in the Gulf. Even though Jesus tells us that storms will happen in our lives, he also gave us the perfect demonstration of what will happen when you don't feed the storm that you're in.
What?
Yes, let me show you. Everybody turn to Mark chapter 4. You need proof. Here it is. Mark chapter 4, verses 35 through 41. Once again, let me paint the picture. Jesus told us storms will come. And he said, if you follow my words and do what I say, it's as if you're building your life on a foundation solid like a rock, which is him. Are y'all with me? But then he said, well, let me show you what happens when you don't feed the storm that you're going to be in. And he did a demonstration. Mark chapter 4, 35 through 41. This is the awe-inspiring, very familiar scripture when Jesus calmed the storm. I want you to look at this. This blew my mind. Dad, get ready to dance because this was awesome. 35, it says, that day when evening came, he said to the disciples, let's go up over the other side. leaving the crowd behind. Let me stop right there. He just got finished feeding the 5,000. A miracle took place. He did a miracle working wonder. He fed people physically, and then he fed them spiritually. They only had 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, and then he blessed it, and it multiplied, and they had leftovers. Are y'all with me? They had leftovers. Are y'all with me? So all this just finished happening. The disciples just saw the awe-inspiring, miracle-working power of Jesus Christ, and then he says here, that evening came after the Spirit of God moved, and he said to the disciples, let's go over to the other side, leaving the crowd behind. And they took him along just as he was in a boat. There were also other boats with him. Verse 37. A furious storm came up, and the waves broke over the boat, so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. So how in the world all this storms is going on and Jesus is rattling the windows and calling the hogs because he's at peace? It was a paradigm shift. The disciples couldn't believe it. So there's a storm raging as soon as they get on the boat, and Jesus is fast asleep. He's getting his beauty rest. The disciples woke him up and they said, teacher, do you not care if we drown? 39, he got up, rebuked the wind, and he said, and said to the waves, quiet, be still. Then the wind died down and was completely calm. Verse 40, and he said to the disciples, this is what blew my mind, why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? 41, they were terrified and they asked each other, who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him. When you are not filled with God's word, when you are not applying his word to your life, building your life on that solid foundation, you are not putting things into practice, and the storm you are in will feed off of anything that is contrary to the word of God. So the Holy Spirit made something very evident. The disciples were afraid and they did not have no faith. And the Holy Spirit said the very storm that they were in were feeding off of their fears and their lack of faith, even though they just witnessed what Jesus did for 5,000 just moments ago. And when we are in a storm, when we're not rooted in his word, we're not grounded in what he says, when we're not holding steadfast to our confessions, when we're in a storm, we are now, what's on the inside of us is anything that is contrary to the word of God that we believe that we're not acting on. And then that storm is feeding on our fears. That storm is feeding on our doubt. That storm is feeding on anything that is not like God. And that's what causes us to be tossed to and fro. And why do you think all he had to do was speak to the storm and say, peace, be still? Yes, Jesus was the walking word. Jesus is the word. But you know what? Jesus also knew what was on the inside of him, and he had no worries. He says, peace, be still. And he is given, if Jesus is living on the inside of us, we have that same power. So whatever storm we're facing, we ought to do what Jesus is doing, what Jesus demonstrated, and tell that storm to peace, be still. Tell that situation, peace, be still. Tell that worry and depression, peace, be still. Anything that is contrary to the word of God, peace, be still.
Amen, amen.
But when this word is not in us, what are we filled with? We're not an empty shell. We're always filled with something. Whether it be a demon or a Holy Spirit, we're filled with something. Amen. So when we're not filled with the word, how that storm gets stronger, it feeds off of what we're putting out. Yes. And we're not putting out the word. If we're putting out damnation, if we're putting out doubt, that storm is feeding it. Mm-hmm. You know, that's what storms need. It needs us doubting that God will bring us through, it gets stronger. That's what storms need. It needs worry and depression to feed and get stronger. That's how it gets stronger. But when we feed, when we're filled with the word of God and what his word says, and we're actively working it out, there's nothing for the storm to feed on. And that storm goes from a category 5 to a category 4 to a category 3, then a tropical storm, then a little bit of rain, and then it's nothing. Why? Because it's the word. It's the spirit of God that's on the inside of us that gives us the strength to carry us out the storm. Our lives are anchored on a solid foundation, and we're not blown to and fro. There's always going to be conditions. If you look outside, it's a clear, sunny day. But there's always elements in the atmosphere that can swiftly change a sunny day to a lightning storm. It's always ever present. It's in the atmosphere. And when we go through storms, it's connected to what's going on in the spirit. That's why we have the Holy Spirit who intercedes for us on the inside, because the Holy Spirit knows what's happening behind the scenes. And when we actively work out the word, we're connected to what the Holy Spirit is saying, and we can speak what the Holy Spirit is saying, which will cause the elements in the natural to conform to the words that are coming out of our mouth, because it's the word of God. And everything bows to the word of God.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. But then, Matthew 26 and 27, chapter 7. Anyone who hears these words of mine and do not put them to practice, they're like a foolish man who builds a house on the sand. The storm will still come. The streams will rise. The winds will beat against it. The winds will blow against the house, and it will fall with a great crash. I'm mesmerized by that sentence Jesus said, peace be still. When you're in your storm, peace be still. You know, I experienced that firsthand when I rode out Hurricane Ivan. It was one of the worst hurricanes that hit Pensacola head on. Hurricane Ivan leveled everything. And if anybody's been to the house, my parents' house, in our backyard, it's really nice and all the trees are cleared and my dad's got it hooked up. But when we first bought that house, that backyard was like a forest. All the pine trees, there was like 50 pine trees back there, at least 50 feet tall. And when and you know what, my dad did a quote because he wanted to cut down the number of them, and it was labeled in the thousands. My dad was like, how am I going to get the money to level all these trees out, because I want to do something for our yard? But then Hurricane Ivan came, and boy, we tried. You know, a little bit of worry came on us. We were hunkered down in the house. The house was shaking just a little bit, and then we heard freight train sounds going all on the sides of our houses. That let us know that tornadoes were all around while Hurricane Ivan was slamming Pensacola head on, and we just heard big clashes. That was the trees in our backyard just crashing down. And I remember my mom and my dad kept on saying, peace be still. Peace be still. They didn't get worried. They continued to speak the word that was planted on the inside of them. Peace be still. Did y'all know that when Hurricane Ivan was over, we went to the backyard and almost all 50 trees were down, but none of them hit my parents' house. There were trees to the side. There were trees to the other side. There were trees all the way in the front. But our roof wasn't damaged. The foundation of the house wasn't damaged. Because why? Because my parents had enough sense to speak what thus said the word. They said, peace be still. And I choose to believe that the Holy Spirit on the inside of them gave them an unction of what to say. And the elements, even in the midst of Hurricane Ivan, had no other choice but to obey.
Amen.
tornadoes came through Nashville, came from Madison all the way to Bordeaux, and every time that that tornado siren would come out, Dad would say, "Peace be still. Peace be still." There wouldn't even be a tornado touching down near us. Dad would say, "Peace be still. Peace be still." But lo and behold, Dad didn't know that there was a storm about to come, but the Holy Spirit on the inside of Daddy Hayes gave him an unction even months ago to say, "Peace be still, peace be still." Because when tornadoes actually ripped through Bordeaux, every house had at least two or three trees toppled down because there was a Category 2 tornado that came through, but not a single branch. And Daddy and Mama Hayes' house was touched. Every tree was remained standing. Because you don't know what the Holy Spirit has you do. You don't know what he has you speak into the elements.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit has the Doppler radar images, knowing what's about to happen years from now.
Amen.
That was Daddy Hayes, Mama Hayes, actively working out the word on the inside of them. They weren't just listeners of the word, they were doers of the word. Because you never know what storm is coming for. Amen.
Amen.
If you can, go ahead and stand in closing. We are saying, we are proclaiming peace. Be still.
Amen.
Every bit of depression, peace. Be still. Every bit of worry, peace. Be still. Every bit of doubt, we're saying, peace, be still. I want you to lift your hands up to the Lord. And you're all, and I want you just to prophesy over your children's life. Peace, be still. You may not know why you're doing it, any future storm that's going on, that may go on, but God is saying, prophesy to the nations, peace, be still. A storm might be a sickness that is riddling through your bloodline. Tell that storm, peace, be still. The blood of Jesus Christ is flowing through my family's vein, and the spirit of infirmity has got to go. Come on, tell him, peace, be still.
Peace, be still.
The spirit of the true and living God is going in and going forward before you as you prophesy what thus saith the Lord. Peace, be still. Every shred of worry and doubt is being still in the name of Jesus. The spirit of infirmity is still, is dead in the name of Jesus. The spirit of lack is, we say, peace, be still. We speak prosperity in the name of Jesus. Whatever storm that may be miles or years away, we are hunkered down. We are anchored in the solid rock. Oh, Christ, the solid rock in which I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. We're not building our lives on a sinking sand. We're building our lives on the rock, which is Jesus Christ. We don't care what anybody else may say to us. It may be status quo. It may be the unpopular thing, but the world will know and they'll see that our houses are planted on the word of God. And so as we move forward, we're not moving. We're not swaying to and fro because we are anchored on the solid rock, which is Jesus Christ. We are anchored on the word of God, which is Jesus Christ. We are anchored because we're connected to the truth.
Amen.
Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Peace be still.
Amen.
Hallelujah. After the Holy Spirit swept in earlier this morning, there was a stillness. The peace of God swept through us. That's the stillness. Come on. They say when you go through a hurricane, actually I've experienced it myself, when you go through a hurricane and then all of a sudden the winds just stop, you're in the eye of the storm, before you go through the other half, which is worse. But guess what? When we're going through the storm, the entire time we're going through the storm, it's as if we're in the eye of the storm. Nothing is phasing us. Do y'all see it? Nothing is affecting us. Nothing is swaying us.
Even when it seems like we're about to go into the worst part of the storm, we're not affected. We're not feeding into it.
Thank you, Lord.
We're not feeding it fear. We're not feeding it doubt. We're not going in with our faith wavering, but we're going in with our faith hunkered down, and we can speak to those elements.
Amen.
We speak to Hurricane Irma right now. We command that it changes its course. I know what the meteorologists have said, but God, we speak right now. We come together as your remnant, and we speak to those elements. We decree and declare that the people of Florida are crying out to you. God, we don't know exactly why this storm has come in. We don't know exactly why this storm has gained jurisdiction, but whatever it is, we thank you that you're using this as a moment to bring in a cleansing, to bring in a restructuring, to bring in a shift so that the people of God can finally be in alignment like more than ever before. And the storms that come into our life, some purposefully because of things that we're doing that is against you, and some that are allowed to happen, we are still going to be anchored on your word. We won't be tossed to and fro.
Amen.
We won't feed into that storm. We will weather the storm, and we will go through with all dunamis power, with the joy of our heart and praise on our lips. And when people see, despite what's around us, we have a different perception, and they can say, who do you serve? And we point them to you. In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name.
If you believe that, say amen and give God a hand.